The following feature presentation is part of the Skywalking Network.
This is what you can look forward to on this heroic episode 332 of Skywalking Through Neverland.
Hey everyone, it's good to see you.
Woo!
Hi, welcome to Avengers Campus.
Even in the bathrooms, you hear the Avengers music. I was like rocking out to Ant-Man.
We want there to be some conflict to the experience, but we don't want anyone to feel that there's an apocalyptic threat to the end of humanity.
But, I mean, kids don't care if it's canon or continuity.
No, they could care less. They're doing the Marvel theme park universe because you can't have Avengers Campus and not have Iron Man. You cannot have Black Widow since her movie's coming out in just a few weeks.
Right.
Where is the Hulk?
Oh, it was so cool.
Are you ready?
Welcome to Neverland.
Here we go.
A long time ago, in a galaxy far, far away.
To all who come to this happy place, welcome. Disneyland is your land.
When I first made Star Wars, everybody in Hollywood said, well, this is a movie Disney should have made.
You're more than just fans. You're family.
It's about family, and that's what's so powerful about it.
Hey, hey.
When you use a bird to write with, it's called tweeting.
When we visit the world of Disney, we never grow old. It's a Peter Pan, never, never land that keeps us young in heart.
This is Jedi Master Obi-Wan Kenobi, and you are skywalking through Neverland. I have a good feeling about this.
Hey, hey, Skywalkers! So, have you been recruited yet at Avengers Campus? Or do you prefer the sights and sound at Galaxy's Edge? Well, let us know. But for right now, we want to welcome everyone to
Skywalking Through Neverland!
I am Richard Woloski, but now everyone please say hello to my sweetie wife, Sarah, the Scarlet Witch to my vision.
Wow. Okay, well, thank you. I'm wearing a Spider-Man shirt, so I was not expecting that.
No, but you to Avengers Campus opening day, you were wearing a Scarlet Witch-inspired dress.
I was Disney-bounding.
You were Disney-bounding.
As Scarlet Witch.
And I was Disney-bounding as Vision.
Yes, and we made a cute couple. I loved it. Ah! Okay. And then we had our friends were also bounding as WandaVision. So we had a whole WandaVision crew.
Yeah, Courtney and Kelly were there.
Mm-hmm.
And together, we all made WandaVision.
Exactly.
Ironically, there's no WandaVision at all in Avengers Campus.
There's not. But, you know, we were the reference. WandaVision.
Yeah.
That's true.
If it weren't for us, there'd be zero reference in Avengers Campus.
It's very true. Oh, my gosh. All right. Well, Skywalkers, welcome, everyone. We are your enthusiastic podcast destination for the many decades of your Star Wars, Disney, and Marvel fandom. So imagine a big Wookiee hug and a sprinkle of pixie dust. We love you 3,000, Skywalkers. You are our family. Now, if you're just listening for the first time, or watching us live in the Sky Chat right now. We are on YouTube and Twitch and Facebook live simulcasting. Then you are now a Skywalker. So join us and the rest of our Skywalker family on a fun and positive adventure through fandom.
Now we are recording this from Long Beach, California on June the 8th, 2021.
We are also being sponsored by Small World Vacations, and they are a diamond-level Disney vacation planner travel agency and can help you book your trip to Disney parks around the world, even to Avengers Campus. And best of all, their service is free of charge, so head to smallworldvacations.com for a no-obligation price quote and tell them that Skywalking Through Neverland sent you. And I'll have you know that they are booking many, many trips for 2022 right now, including on the new Disney Wish, which is their new ship, and lots and lots of things at Walt Disney World. And if you want to plan for Avengers Campus here at Disneyland, just all kinds of things, just head to smallworldvacations.com.
And they will get busy really soon with Galactic Star Cruiser.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. AKA the Star Wars Hotel. All right, now, coming up on this episode, we compare and contrast all aspects of Avengers Campus to Galaxy's Edge. We'll break down the immersive atmosphere, the merchandise, the attractions, food and drinks.
Also the character interaction, the land layout, opening day accessibility, and the overall story of each land. And we also want to hear what you think about each, or if you haven't been yet, let us know in the Sky Chat if you have any questions at all. So now,
Avengers Assemble!
All right, now let's start off with comparing and contrasting the story.
All right, so Avengers Campus. The story here takes place in the Marvel theme park universe in which the blip did not occur. This is an alternate universe that's parallel to the Marvel multiverse.
Now, Dan Fields, the executive creative director for Disney Parks Live Entertainment, he says, "We want there to be some conflict to the experience, but we don't want anyone to feel that there's an apocalyptic threat to the end of humanity." And the guests are recruits to help the Avengers help with any future non-apocalyptic threats.
Oh, okay. Well, Dormammu is pretty apocalyptic, but
not in the way that Thanos was. With one snap, he wiped out half the world.
Right. All right, tell us about Galaxy's Edge.
Okay, with Galaxy's Edge, this storyline takes place between The Last Jedi and The Rise of Skywalker, and guests visit Blackspire Outpost and either side with the First Order, who are trying to find Resistance sympathizers, or they can join the Resistance, who are trying to recruit and oppose the First Order, or they can make their way through the streets and talk with the citizens who are just trying to make their way peacefully on Batuu.
They can also become smugglers on the app as well.
Very, very true. Very true.
Right. So those are our two storyline layouts. So what is our verdict on the story for Galaxy's Edge versus Avengers Campus?
All right. For me, Galaxy's Edge takes it. The story is more streamlined. It's streamlined from canon, so there's nothing contradicting itself. I was confused with the Avengers Campus storyline and why there were characters that didn't make it out of Infinity War.
Right.
Because there's Black Widow running around. Like, oh, did you not see Infinity War?
And Iron Man.
So I was very confused. And I just figured maybe they were not going to be concerned with continuity. So unless there's a flow chart as you enter Avengers Campus about the theme park universe, you would never really know what's going on. However, if there wasn't such an overall emphasis on continuity, then I like a theme park universe better since it doesn't box you in.
Okay.
And overall, I think people would have liked a theme park universe with Galaxy's Edge because they want to see Darth Vader. They want to see Luke and Leia and Han.
Right. I agree. And I would like to see those characters too.
Right.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. So my verdict, I guess give a little bit of an edge to Galaxy's Edge just because I know where that story falls. Like if you had told me Avengers Campus was supposed to be in a kind of a multiverse continuity, I wouldn't have known. I was just kind of like bombarded by characters. I was like, oh, this is cool. Okay, I'm here for it.
I didn't know there was a Marvel a theme park universe.
No, not at all.
But you know what? I like that.
Right. I like it too. So I give a slight edge to Galaxy's Edge in this storyline because walking in, you can kind of tell where you are within the story that you know.
All right, now let's talk about the land layout. All right, with Avengers Campus, I love that when you walk in, you see the big Spidey building where Spidey does his show on a regular occurrence, and down the main strip, you come to a very large open area where you can watch the Black Widow show. However, the thick handrails on the upper level of the show building were not thought through since it hides a lot of the action. Mm-hmm. And if you watch our video, which we just posted today, opening day at Avengers Campus, you'll see how these big thick handrails block a lot of the action and the costuming as the characters are out there waving to the audience.
Mm-hmm.
And to the right of the plaza is the Doctor Strange Mystery of the Mystic Arts Theater. And I love that because it's like little like buried behind there. Away. Yeah. Oh, I love that. And then in the opposite direction to the Mystic Arts Theater, you have the Guardians of the Galaxy Mission Breakout attraction. And now this finally feels like it's part of a bigger land.
Yes. It fits right along that main street, that main strip.
Yeah. So this is kind of like Toy Story Land, where it's really it's a straight run through, which is curved. It has like an arch to it.
What do you mean by toy? Oh, Toy Story Land. Yeah. Yes, yes.
At Hollywood Studios. Hollywood Studios.
Okay, gotcha. Yeah, Cars Land is a main street, but that's straight down. But it's about the same size as Cars Land?
Yeah, it's not that big. And okay. Cars Land is just beautiful.
It is. Whereas this is more techie, I would say.
Yeah. That's a whole different topic right there.
Right. And Galaxy's Edge, of course, is an even larger area. What is it? Like 13 acres?
14 acres, yes.
Wow. And of course, it has different streets, different alcoves. You have this whole section of the Resistance. And then that feeds into the marketplace, which then branches out into like three different areas. You know, you have the Millennium Falcon area, you have your First Order area, it's like way bigger, basically.
Right.
So what is our verdict?
What is your verdict? You go first this time.
Okay. So I would have to definitely give this to Galaxy's Edge because it is bigger. Everything's more spread out. You have kind of those multiple feels and vantage points in the land. Like you can be in one part of the land and feel a totally different tone and atmosphere than another part, right? Like it makes you feel you're in totally different places. Like the First Order section is definitely very rigid, I would say. And then you get to like the Docking Bay 7, the eating area, and it's just a very chill location right there. And even the opening day when it was dark at Galaxy's Edge, we didn't find Savi's workshop until the very end because it's tucked away in this tiny corner. If you didn't know it's there, you didn't know where to go. Yeah. So, yeah.
I love those places that are tucked away and maybe don't see it the first time around.
Also, I have to say that the walk in to the land, Galaxy's Edge, is fantastic. Going under the bridge, the cavern.
Yeah, you feel like you are really transposing yourself from one land to another.
Yes.
In touch of a mythic way.
Right. Where Avengers Campus, you definitely feel like you've entered a new space because of the superhero music pumping. I do like that, but it's just a different feel.
Now going back to the theme park universe,
yes.
Fruity Groovy in the Sky Chat says, if you think about it, the Marvel theme park universe is a direct result of the 2014 Thanos being defeated in Endgame, creating a splintered timeline.
Oh,
I get that and all, but I also get why, once again, they're doing this. They're doing the Marvel theme park universe because you can't have Avengers Campus and not have Iron Man. You cannot have Black Widow since her movie's coming out in just a few weeks.
Right. Yeah. And let's see. Kelly's saying, I didn't know there was a storyline for Avengers Campus other than getting recruited. But Courtney says she likes both lands, but she likes the fact that you are a recruit in Avengers Campus. So I feel like they draw you in a little bit more.
Well, you're also recruited in the Resistance at Galaxy's Edge.
Right, or the First
Order. Once upon a time when they had Vi sneaking around and other citizens would kind of whisper to you, hey, we're having a meeting in 10 minutes, meet us over here. So they were recruiting you. That just didn't last more than the opening day.
Right.
All right, now I'm the same way. I like Galaxy's Edge. That edges out the layout for Avengers Campus. And mainly because it's a bigger area. You have 14 acres and there's more areas to explore off the hub. And it takes you a little longer to see everything. And you can go off in different directions instead of one straight runway.
Right. Kelly's bringing up a good point in the Sky Chat. She says Galaxy's Edge feels like you're not in Disneyland. Whereas in Avengers Campus, they don't hide the fact that you're in a theme park. Spider-Man even says he can see a roller coaster.
Whoa, I can see a roller coaster from here.
That is a very good point.
Yeah, so they're not being cornered in a box where everything is just so hindered on continuity and canon.
Right.
So there's something to be said for that. And I think if you ask most people, they would go for that way. Throw continuity out the window and just go with this theme park continuity so mm-hmm. we can have more.
Yeah, I agree. More of what people want, basically. But I mean, yes. kids don't care if it's canon or continuity.
No, they could care less.
So, Richard, why don't you tell us about the immersive atmosphere in Avengers Campus?
In Avengers Campus, the music plays a very big part, just like a soundtrack to a film. When the shows are starting up, you know it because the music blares from the sound system.
And we mean blare.
And there's no missing it.
Yeah.
And the Black Widow show, it's dynamic, it's action-packed. However, they could use more colorful characters because you have a lot of very dark costume characters like Black Widow, Black Panther, Taskmaster, and the henchmen. And they're all wearing almost the same kind of masks except for Black Widow, who is wearing a COVID mask.
And then we do have to say that they are up on this balcony that's half cut off by these big railings.
Those big thick handrails that we were talking about earlier.
Yeah.
Yeah. And once again, watch the video and you'll go, oh, I see that.
Why can't we see more of the characters? Because we couldn't see more of the characters. And you had your camera really high up too.
Yeah, and I could really hardly see anything. And they had this big tree right in front of the main action and these big street lights.
Yeah, those street lights were like really bad.
And you know why they put them there? To hide flaws.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
Interesting.
Like you put a hood on a character when you want to hide a seam. Now, unless you know the storyline and characters of Doctor Strange, it's a little hard to follow the bigger picture of the mysteries of the Mystic Arts show. However, if you just know that Doctor Strange teaches students the Mystic Arts, and then everyone's got to put their new skills to the test to battle Dormammu, you're good there. But he's throwing out stuff like Dashanti and Dormammu, who I had forgotten who that was. And
oh yeah, Dormammu's the big purple face guy that he fights at the end.
Right, which I didn't know that we see Dormammu.
Oh, okay.
When the door's open, he's there, but some reason I just...
You didn't put it together.
Yeah, because it's
You're probably looking at his costume.
It's all 4K in that big projection area, so it just all blended into each other, so
Wait
I didn't
a
know
minute.
It was there. It's too bright. And that's my deal with these projection screens. They're too bright. There's no contrast. Like with film, you can get a separation. Here, it's just one big light screen. So that's why I didn't see Dormammu until I was editing the video. It's like,
oh, funny.
Hey, wait a minute. That's a face in there. Yeah, so with the Doctor Strange show, he's throwing out all these names, but once again, you just know that he's going to be teaching everyone skills to fight Dormammu in the end. That's pretty much all you need to know.
Yeah, it's cool.
All right, so tell everyone now about the immersive atmosphere in Galaxy's Edge.
All right, so at the original opening of Galaxy's Edge, you really had a big immersive feel. You know, you felt like you were a character in the story. There was characters walking around beside you, around you. Stormtroopers would come up and ask to see your identification, right? And all the citizen cast members were Batuu citizens, and they had backstories, like where they lived, where they came in from every day.
Their hobbies.
Right, you could hear ships flying overhead. Creatures in the bushes. Well, you still can hear those, mm-hmm, right? Mm-hmm. And you can also see lots of footprints from like R2 and 3PO and other droids in the resistance area. So it was really neat.
And also there's lots of very recognizable ships spread throughout the land, like the TIE Echelon, an X-Wing, a A-Wing. You have the Millennium Falcon, of course.
Mm-hmm.
And also walking around once upon a time, Galaxy's Edge, you had Kylo Ren and his troopers, and they always struck fear as they strode by. People would run from them.
Or little kids.
Right. Yeah. And you just can't beat having the Millennium Falcon as the centerpiece. And no matter what they say over at Avengers Campus, the Quinjet doesn't even come close. It's a jet.
Well, that's very true. So, verdict. Maybe I'll go first.
Okay.
All right. So, well, before we do that, let me just, some people are describing the atmosphere here. Let's see. So Kelly's saying, I love that there is Avengers music. Yes, Kelly, me too. Courtney says, Avengers Campus is very immersive as everywhere you look, there's an Avenger doing something. And that is very true, too. They make up great points. So my verdict is, honestly, I'm going to go with Avengers Campus for this one because I think the music has a really big influence on me here. Because you walk into Avengers Campus, you are immediately bombarded with that Avengers music, and you have this music going throughout. It has like it cycles through the Ant-Man theme, you get the Spider-Man theme, Captain America theme, the Avengers theme. You know, you get all of these themes just cycling through. And also, like Richard, you said, it's incorporated into the shows that all of a sudden the themes get louder and, you know, you hear the Doctor Strange theme in his show. It's beautiful. You hear some of the Dora Milaje when they come out, you hear the Black Panther theme as well as when he appears for the Black Widow show. Even in the bathrooms, you hear the Avengers music. I was like rocking out to Ant-Man in the bathroom. So I love this. I wish Galaxy's Edge had this. Yes, they have an in-universe radio station, but I really wish they would just break that in-universe fourth wall when it comes to music and bring in that John Williams music just pumping throughout the whole land. I mean, can you imagine like the Imperial March happening when the First Order soldiers come in? I know they're First Order, but I don't care. Like, I want to hear the Imperial March. And also,
well, the Imperial March is in universe.
Right.
We hear
that's
it in
true.
Rebels. We hear it in Solo.
That is very
during
true.
During the recruitment videos.
Right. But also, wouldn't it be cool? You know, you have that atmospheric music when you walk into Galaxy's Edge, but what if you just heard a little horn solo of the Force theme coming in? Right? Yes.
I've got some counterpoints.
Okay.
Because you do hear John Williams music. You hear the Galaxy's Edge suite as you're walking into Galaxy's Edge. You do hear it. And
right.
When you're at Savi's workshop building your lightsabers, at the very end when everyone ignites their lightsabers, we do hear the John Williams music.
But that's not what I'm talking about, because that's only if you pay to enter and
but,
hear
right,
it
but
in that
still,
one place.
You can't say that there's not music anywhere. Plus, we have music at Olga's Cantina,
right,
which the
Turkel
just said is opening back up June 17th.
Right.
And you also hear, like you said earlier, a music...
The radio station, but
radio
that's
station.
Not from the movies. And I want to hear music from the movies. That's what I want to hear. And I understand that there's some music sprinkled throughout, like even in Smuggler's Run, you'll hear the Star Wars music, but I want to hear it as you're walking through the land. Like when they had Star Wars like days in November, what was that called? Over in Tomorrowland?
Oh, Season of the Force.
Season of the Force. You walk in and you hear the music, you know, like from the prequels and everything. They just cycle through all the different themes. And I loved that. It was beautiful.
I'm not arguing about that. And I'll go over that in just a second, but when we had Season of the Force, they rotated through four themes. It's like, didn't we just hear the Cantina theme 8 minutes ago?
Well, I loved it, all right? But, and we do have, so Jack is saying he heard that the Avengers Campus music gets old because the playlist is limited and gets repetitive.
I didn't notice that.
I did not notice that either, because I think you're just bombarded by so many things. If all you're listening for is the music, yes, I think you hear the same themes. But for me, there was so much to look at and so much to see that it did not bug me. I thought it was cool.
Now, I don't think there's music playing all over the land. I think when the shows are starting up, you'll hear the music.
No, it is playing throughout.
Okay.
It is.
Yeah. So that's more to the point that you're not always listening to the music because there's so many visuals that you're looking at. And every once in a while, a theme might seep into your consciousness, but then you're looking at something else.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't, well, Kelly and Courtney, you were there all weekend. Did you ever experience the music getting repetitive? Tell us
in
the Sky Chat.
They were there a couple days, right? Well, so I'm eager to see like when Avengers Campus does settle down a little bit. I wonder how it's going to be to just sit and like chill with a beer, right? By like Pim's Test Kitchen, which is in that main area.
Mm-hmm.
Will it be similar to sitting in Galaxy's Edge on that overlook by the Falcon? And I don't know, because right now my impression of Avengers Campus is this very frenetic energy, because we were there on opening day when they were letting too many people in and it was super crowded and crazy, whereas Galaxy's Edge is way more chill.
All right, now for me, when judging immersive atmosphere, this is tough, because overall I would have to go with Avengers Campus.
Oh?
But I understand why Galaxy's Edge didn't go with a music soundtrack to keep the experience more immersive within the story. And there's no shows, which is a huge plus for Avengers Campus. There's no shows going on at Galaxy's Edge. Even though in the beginning they said, oh, tons of pop-up shows, those never, ever happened. And I'm so disappointed, because you see those little staging areas in Galaxy's Edge where things could happen, but they never did. They had one show at the opening for Galaxy's Edge here in Disneyland,
which we missed.
Yep, that one show, and that was it.
Yeah.
And Galaxy's Edge really fell apart with their reopening just a couple of weeks ago. And you'll see this in our Galaxy's Edge over quarantine video. Cast members rarely had a backstory. You didn't see that in the video because we cut it out. And
that's true.
They would run when you asked them questions, which we kept in, looking at you, Vi Marotti. But as we always say, big props to the cast members over there, Sen and Joel, who work at Black Spire Outpost, and their cast members who stayed on top of their jobs during quarantine, and they were always ready to talk.
They're amazing. Yes.
Yeah. So because Galaxy's Edge does not have shows, this has to go to Avengers Campus.
All right. So I said Avengers Campus because of the music. You said Avengers Campus because of the shows.
Because of the shows. Yeah.
Interesting.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Now, Jack Vasfury brings up a very good point in the Sky Chat. He says, Galaxy's Edge needs random droids and aliens walking around.
And that was proposed, and that was supposed to be happening.
Yes.
Never played out.
That would be amazing.
It really, really would.
So that brings us to character interaction. So in Avengers Campus, Disney did a great job with casting lookalikes. You'll see Loki, pictures of Loki, of Thor, Doctor Strange. Fantastic. He turned around like right in front of us. You'll see it in the video. And like, I think you can hear me gasp because he just looked like incredible. Oh my gosh.
Mm-hmm. And I'm sure their patter is right on point as well. We wouldn't know because they were not mic'd.
No, that's very true.
Except for Doctor Strange in this little arena, this little theater. And the other characters that were up on that second story of the Avengers building, and they're talking to the crowd. It's like, we can't hear you.
Especially with the music.
Yeah. They don't project, which I understand, because if they're there 8 hours a day, they're not going to. But if you're not going to project, have a PA system out there.
Yeah, I hope they give them PAs, because I would really hope so.
Yeah, Disney needs to go over to Knott's Berry Farm and see their performers who are up on balconies. They're mic'd. You can hear what they're saying.
Yeah.
You'll see that in our Knott's Berry Farm 100th anniversary video.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. So I just wished that we could hear them as well as see them.
Right.
Now, at Galaxy's Edge, Rey is always on point. She looks great. There's a couple of Reys. One is a little bit better than the other. And she sounds just like Daisy Ridley. She could be a voice double for Daisy Ridley. And once again, the Kylo Ren and his stormtroopers always struck fear as they're walking by the guests at Black Spire Outpost. They're looking for resistance scum. When Kylo Ren turns to you, you shiver. You give him your wallet, you give him your car keys, whatever he asks for, you just give it to him. And Chewie is working on ships. He's been working on the X-Wing. Vi Marotti is sneaking around and speaking to guests. So there's a lot of great interaction with Galaxy's Edge. So Sarah, what is your verdict for character interaction?
All right. Well, I do have to say that Avengers Campus takes this, especially right now. That was my huge takeaway from opening day. We walk into Avengers Campus. All of a sudden, Spider-Man is, hey guys, what you doing? Watch me go. And he does some flips and he's like flying high over the buildings. Look at that roller coaster, guys. It was so amazing. Like, we walked in at the perfect moment where that show just started up and we're like, oh, oh my God. And then that's just at the edge of Avengers Campus. And then we walk into the heart of the campus and you see Ant-Man and Wasp. They're meeting and greeting. And then Sam Wilson, Captain America, is like up above and he's waving to the crowd along with Black Widow and Black Panther, and they're on the Avengers building, right? And then Black Widow starts up her show and you see Taskmaster and you see, and she's like doing these, she's on a rope, you know, like climbing down from the top of the building to the stage. And it was just so neat. And then that show finishes and immediately all the cast members are like scooting us back in a row. And we look to our left and the Dora Milaje are like walking up the street in this like impromptu parade, like doing their awesome thing with their, with the stick. Like, oh my God. I teared up. I was like, look at this. It's so amazing. They were like doing this procession and they walked right by me because I was right in front. Oh, it was so cool. So that was my impression of Avengers Campus, was just these characters and like the Doctor Strange show with the Thor cameo. I mean, I screamed when I saw Thor. I was like, ah, it's Thor. So plus if you happen to see those characters on ground level walking to and from their spots, that's even a better interaction too, because you can kind of, if you ask them a question, they'll talk to you like Loki.
Oh yeah.
Yeah. So like earlier, we'll tell that earlier, Loki was up on the building and I think we were trying to talk to him and you couldn't hear what he said. So I think you started saying Loki, Loki. So we all started chanting Loki, Loki. And he's like, you know, going along with it, Loki. And then Richard,
we needed to do something, yes, where he could play along to it. Cause you can't ask him questions.
No.
Cause he'll answer. It's like, I've got no idea what you just said.
Right. So we were like, Loki, Loki.
Yeah. Loki, Thor, Loki, yeah. Loki. Thor.
Yeah. Richard kept saying Thor. Later on that day, like an hour later, he's walking to his off stage and walking right through and he looks at us and he goes, I don't like you, right? And
something to that effect,
something,
yeah,
to that. And then he like gestures at the rest of us and says, oh, I like you guys. It was so funny, but it was great. It was awesome.
Yeah, so you get a little bit of character interactions as they're walking backstage.
Right.
But they don't stop. They can't take pictures.
Right.
Because the cast members would just, you know, usher them along.
Yeah, so Galaxy's Edge, I mean, they have characters and we've been interacting with them, but they only have those same, like, four or five characters. So you have Chewie, Rey, Vi Marotti, Stormtroopers, and Kylo Ren. That's five. And they just cycle through and it's great. Like, it's really cool. You can have some great interaction, but it's not the same as like characters hitting you from every side and in the shows and everything like that.
Mm-hmm.
My mind goes to Avengers Campus.
All right. Now, Joshua Jordan in the Sky Chat, he reminds us that there were going to be droids rolling around Galaxy's Edge. And we saw one at D23 Expo a couple of years ago and it looked great. And Joshua says that the problem I saw in the video is that kids would try to climb on it or kick it, and that just they just couldn't let that happen. However, if they're concerned with that, then pair the droid up with a handler / owner of the droid.
Droid mechanic or something.
Something where someone would be accompanying the droid. That way, that wouldn't happen.
Very true.
All right. For me, character interaction, this is hard because we're comparing before and after quarantine. And now the characters in Galaxy's Edge before the pandemic, we can get up close and personal with them. And with Avengers Campus, we don't know what that's going to be like because we can't get up close and personal. Black Widow was on point. She was very good.
Right.
And I did ask Captain Marvel if she could find someone to turn down the music, because the music was really loud by her area, and she gave me a nod in agreement, like, yeah, I know what you're talking about. Now, all right, I got to bring this up. If they can do a meet and greet Groot, why can't they do a meet and greet Hulk. It stuck out that one of the classic Avengers, one of the classic Avengers, was not represented. And how many times did I complain about that all day long? Where is the Hulk? And I know, how do you do a walk around meet and greet character like this and have it not be laughable?
Right.
Because remember those Hard Rock Cafe restaurants of the early to mid 90s that were all Marvel themed? They did have like a big Hulk walking around, but it was like a big foam suit and looked very cartoony.
Oh, really?
But once again, they have Groot. That Groot looks fantastic.
It is.
So let's get the Hulk out there doing something. Even if it was just an animatronic, the way that Mr. Potato Head is at the Pixar Pier.
Oh, yeah.
What do you call that?
Yeah, that would be neat. The Toy Story Mania.
Yeah, exactly. Mm-hmm. Or even Doc Ondar or Hondo Onaka.
Right.
Those all work as animatronic. Hmm. So let's get the Hulk in there. Come on. Really? All right. So normally I would say Galaxy's Edge has the upper hand, but the live immersive feel just fell apart with the reopening. So, I gotta go with a tie on this one.
Oh, okay. All right.
Yeah. All right, now let's move on to food and drinks.
All right, so food and drink, and we'll just give you a baseline here. Galaxy's Edge has Docking Bay 7, Oga's Cantina, which is reopening June 17th, Ronto Roasters, your walk-up place, Katsaka's Kettle, which has your popcorn, Blue Milk Stand, which has, of course, blue milk, and the Droid Carts, which has your drinks and some more snacks. That's six things, right? So Avengers Campus has Shawarma Palace, two of those carts, Pim's Test Kitchen, which is your main food, Pim's Tasting Lab, which is where you can get the drinks, Terran Treats, which is a dessert cart, and then the regular DCA carts, which has your regular Mickey bars and things. And that's five things. So, Richard.
All right, so now, okay, want me to go first?
Sure. What's your verdict?
I'm going to have to once again go with Galaxy's Edge.
All right.
Because they serve food that you can't get anywhere else. It was specialized to the land. I love the blue and green milk that gives it another immersive touch to the land. The food at Avengers Campus was good. It was very, very good, but you can get it anywhere. A pretzel? I can go down to Ralph's Supermarket and get a pretzel in 5 minutes.
But a quantum pretzel? That's 459 grams?
Yeah, it's a pretzel, okay? It looked fun because it's a big pretzel. And the sandwiches were good. And hold that for 1 second.
Okay.
The various sizes of the food from Pim's Kitchen give this a nice immersive touch, because you would have a chicken sandwich that went wrong. So you have a big piece of chicken and a little tiny bun.
Mm-hmm.
And now we got to talk about the peanut butter and jelly and banana and bacon sandwich.
It's the PB3J, something like that.
I don't know what it is. I don't know what it's called. I don't care, because I'll never get this again. This was the most disgusting thing I've ever tasted in my life.
I liked it.
I like peanut butter and jelly. I like peanut butter and jelly with banana. Why do you need to ruin a good thing by throwing in bacon?
You like bacon.
I love bacon. I love bacon so much. I just don't love bacon and a peanut butter, jelly, and banana sandwich.
Okay.
So I'm gonna, once again, go with Galaxy's Edge.
Okay.
Because they get the Ronto wraps, which are very, very good. They have that tip-yip over at Docking Bay 7,
mm-hmm.
there's so many good things that I can't go down to the supermarket and get.
Okay.
So Galaxy's Edge, check.
Gives it the check. Okay. I will actually have to call this one a tie.
Oh.
Yes. Even though Galaxy's Edge has more variety of places to eat, I do have to say that I like Avengers Campus. And I'm not a lush or anything, but I like Avengers Campus for the accessibility to alcohol. Because they have that Pim's Tasting Lab with the beer. And one of the things I love to do at DCA is have a beer. So it's nice to have something that's a fun beer that's different. Because it's not just beer that they serve there. They have like beer cocktails. So What I tried was a molecular meltdown, and this is dark beer. It has a scoop of real vanilla bean ice cream in it and some marshmallows in it. And the beer is like marshmallow beer. I don't know. It's not sweet per se, but just all the flavors just melded. And I like a deep imperial beer. And I also like Hefeweizen. Like, I'm very... two notes, but yeah, so that was amazing. That was like my favorite thing. I want it again. Like, and if we go back, you know, on Thursday, Richard, we're getting our own, because I'm not sharing.
You're not sharing? I've never heard this from you before in my life.
I know, but also you get it in these cool little cups.
Okay. Yeah, it's like a little tasting, it's like a little test tube cup.
Now, I do have to give it, this is a tie, because Galaxy's Edge does have more recognizable drinks, I would say. Like, Blue Milk is way better known than Pingo Dolce from, I guess, Ant-Man. I don't know what Pingo Dolce is, and I don't remember it in the film, so there you go. Whereas Blue Milk is very recognizable. But Avengers Campus has shawarma, and that's what the Avengers ate at the very end of the Battle of New York in the first Avengers film, and I was so excited to try it, and I thought it was really good. So it's a tie for me, because there's good. Olga's Cantina, of course, is amazing, right? But it also is hard to get in and pricey, whereas the Pim's Tasting Lab is a little easier to get the beer. So there you
now,
have it.
Now, Josh in the Sky Chat says, I heard the drinks at Avengers Campus are filled from the bottom.
Yes.
Now, I didn't get the drinks. You did. Did you see this?
I did not see it because a show was going on at the same time right behind, and I was focused on filming that. Okay. So I did not see the drinks getting filled.
All right. How about this battle? A fuzzy tauntaun from Galaxy's Edge versus the molecular meltdown from Avengers Campus.
Molecular meltdown.
Oh. Okay.
You?
Oh. You know what? I'm going to have to call this one another tie.
Oh?
Because the fuzzy tauntaun makes your tongue all fuzzy, makes you feel all warm inside.
Okay.
But the molecular meltdown, that hit you. I had two sips, and that hit me faster than any drink at Galaxy's Edge.
Okay.
So each one has got their own plus. But if I had a chance to get either one, that's a very hard choice. I like the taste of the fuzzy tauntaun.
Okay.
But I like the fact that the molecular meltdown makes you feel like you can't drive for another 20 minutes.
Yeah, the fuzzy tauntaun, you don't hardly feel anything.
Yeah. Wait, Courtney says the Pingo Dolce drink is from the Hulk.
Oh, the Incredible Hulk. Okay. Now I remember this. This is the drink. Like, wasn't he working in a factory where they were bottling this beverage and some of his blood got in the soda?
No. You're thinking of Laverne and Shirley. The Schatz Brewery. No?
No, okay. It's from the movie. Now I remember. It's like, it's weird. But okay, so now I have a question for you. Ronto wrap versus the shawarma wrap. Because it's virtually, I mean, you have wraps. So
Ronto wrap.
Okay.
Ronto wrap. The shawarma was good. It was just not memorable.
So I would have to go with the Ronto-less wrap. Mm. That's my favorite.
Mm-hmm.
However, the shawarma is a close second, and then the Ronto wrap. Because the Ronto wrap just has too much meat. I don't know. But the shawarma wrap was interesting. If it was just the shawarma wrap by itself, I would be like, no, that doesn't win at all. But it came with the tzatziki sauce with the fresh cucumber and cut up tomato. And that was really good to dip in. So it was a little messier to eat, though, just in general.
Yeah.
But I did enjoy that shawarma wrap, and I would get it again.
All right. Courtney, you had said in the Sky Chat about the drinks. Yes, they are filled from the bottom. Did you see this? How are they filled from the bottom? How does this work?
I don't know. They must. I'm not sure how it works.
Because in the cup that you had, the molecular.
Right. There's no like hole.
Meltdown cup. There's no.
Right. There's no hole.
Hold for the drinks to. I don't know.
Oh, so Pingo Dolce. I cannot say that. I'm so sorry. I'm butchering it. But Jack is asking, is it spiked? No, it is not spiked here. It is in the land. It is a lemon lime soda with a vanilla kick.
Okay.
That's what it is.
Well, Jack also says it's from the Incredible Hulk, the soda that Stan Lee drinks.
Hmm. Oh. Why did I think it was from Ant-Man? Maybe because it's in Pim's tasting lab.
Well, yeah.
Okay. Sorry. I know a lot of Marvel, but I apparently don't know what they eat. Except for shawarma.
except for shawarma. Right. Now, let's move on to attractions.
Okay. So, Galaxy's Edge has Smuggler's Run and, of course, the E-plus ticket attraction, Rise of the Resistance.
Okay. Avengers Campus has Web Slingers, Guardians of the Galaxy Mission Breakout, and sometime in the future, some E-plus ticket of a Quinjet attraction. Stop with the Quinjet. You're not going to make this into a Millennium Falcon, okay?
But you get to board a Quinjet and go to Wakanda. That's apparently what you get to do.
Just say the Wakanda attraction. Don't call it a Quinjet because I lose all interest when you say Quinjet attraction.
Okay. Well, you know what? We watched a lot of S.H.I.E.L.D., Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., and they boarded the Quinjet a lot. I thought it was like their home.
And?
It was their home. If it wasn't for S.H.I.E.L.D., I don't think I'd care too much about the Quinjet.
Well, you see a lot in the Avengers films.
I know.
But it's a jet.
It doesn't have a personality like the Falcon.
Right. All right. Think. So, okay. Sarah? I know
oh my gosh.
This is going to be a tough one.
This is because we have not ridden Web Slingers yet. We got a backup boarding group on and we didn't make it in. So
we didn't get on the first boarding pass
right.
in the morning.
Right.
Somehow we just weren't fast enough. Then came the second round and we all made it in. But it was boarding group 167.
Right.
And they
got to like 150 or something that day.
Yeah.
Oh.
So we were shut out.
Yes, we were. So honestly, we can't comment too much right now. So I guess, I mean, like right now, I guess I'd give it to Galaxy's Edge because, you know,
because we've been on the attractions.
Who loves riding the Falcon, right?
Yeah.
I mean, I love Mission Breakout, you know, Guardians ride. I think that's a fun ride. And it was really cool having it within the land because the lines were really short because the land is cut off right now. Right. So, yeah.
So here's same here.
Okay.
You know, I look forward to slinging a web any size and catching thieves just like flies. It just wasn't going to happen last Thursday. And
Friday. But yes.
On Friday? Friday. See, I'm so distraught.
I know.
I'm still in this quandary of what day is it?
Well, Kelly is saying that Web Slingers is like the Toy Story Mania ride with no gun.
Yeah. But, you know, okay, Kelly and Courtney, you've been on this. Can this hold up to something like Rise of the Resistance?
But so Kelly is comparing it to Smuggler's Run because in Smuggler's Run, you get to interact with the game. Like you're either the pilot or you're shooting something or you're the engineer. Whereas in Web Slingers, you are catching spider bots that are multiplying.
Wait, are you catching spider bots or
are you spinning webs at
spider bots?
Yeah, you're spinning.
Oh, okay.
You're catching the spider bots with your webs in the Web Slinger machine.
Right. Gotcha. Yes. Okay.
Yeah.
Well, maybe on next week's episode, we'll do an addendum.
Yeah.
That we finally went on Web Slingers.
Okay.
All right, now let's talk about this opening day accessibility.
Ooh, okay. Well, Galaxy's Edge really planned out for tons and tons of crowds, especially over here in the West Coast, because this was going to be opening first over here several months before Galaxy's Edge on the East Coast. And so they did this 4-hour reservation system the whole month before they opened to the general public. Like they had 4-hour slots every day. And this really lessened the opening day demand. In fact, it really lessened the whole summer demand because people were scared off. But one of the things about this is if you had a reservation, if you were going to Disneyland for that day, you knew you would get in. You knew, even if it was only for 4 hours, you knew it. And crowds were always manageable because they had planned on the amount of people per 4-hour window. Now, Avengers Campus,
They were caught off guard, which boggles my mind.
Yes.
I had spoken to one of the supervisors that morning. She was like, yeah, we were so caught off guard. We didn't expect all these people. Do you not know your own property?
I don't know.
You don't know how rabid Marvel fans are? Plus, opening day Disney attraction, opening day Disneyland, fans? Mm-hmm. You put those two together. How did you not see this?
Right. And I'm sure some people, because there's no annual pass holders right now, I'm sure some people waited, had to budget, and waited for the opening day of Avengers Campus to actually go to Disneyland, right?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, yeah, basically, even though the whole place was at 35% capacity, all that 35% capacity of DCA wanted to be in Avengers Campus. And yeah, so opening day was the only day that they allowed mobile orders. They honored those within the land. Like, you could basically get a fast pass to walk in.
I don't think they thought that part through.
No, they didn't, because as they were letting people in, people didn't want to leave. So it just got kept getting more crowded and more crowded and more crowded. It was a big cluster F. That's just
all right, basically. So I'm sure I can already guess your verdict.
Yes, yes. Yeah, so obviously it would be Galaxy's Edge for this. They planned that out. Like, if they had had even three-hour windows for Avengers Campus, because it is a smaller area, and they had walk-on to web slingers rather than the virtual queue. Like, once you're in the land for your three-hour time slot, you could go on web slingers. Mm-hmm. I think that would have been cool, because then you could experience everything within the land. Like, for us, we were there opening day. We experienced everything but the e-ticket attraction, right?
Yeah,
and
exactly,
so
yeah.
That was a little bit of a bummer. But, I mean, we still had a great time, but it was a little bit of a bummer. So
I think the person who coordinated the Galaxy's Edge opening left to maybe go to Knott's Berry Farm, because mm-hmm. Knott's Berry does recruit. They headhunt over at Disney.
Everyone at Knott's who's higher up, and we've spoke to them all, have worked at Universal and Disney.
Well, just when that one supervisor said, yeah, we weren't expecting this.
Oh, yeah.
Are you guys all trainees? How is this happening? All right, for me, same thing. Galaxy's Edge. If it weren't for mobile ordering, we'd still be in line right now. And there wasn't even a guarantee that you would get into Avengers Campus if you had gone to Disney's California Adventure that day. There was no guarantee you would have gotten into the land. And I'm sure somewhere in the small print, it says that if you buy a ticket, there's no guarantee for anything.
Right.
And I'm sure there's a lot of very angry theme park goers that day who said, I bought a ticket to get in. And Disney said, oh, look at the small print.
Right. And I do know that Mike Celestino got there at 6:30 a.m. in line, and he was still waiting, like, outside Avengers. Like, he didn't get in to Avengers Campus right away on opening day. Mm. You know, so only the people who got there between, like, 4 and 5 a.m. were able to get in right away to Avengers Campus. And everybody else, you had to get in either if you had a Web Slingers virtual queue or if you had mobile order food, which they are not doing that anymore, just to let you know. Mobile order food was only the first day. So you can't make a mobile order now unless you're, like, within the land. And they are taking walk-ups for food within the land now, too.
So unless you are app savvy.
Yep.
There's no way you can visit Disneyland ever again.
Or unless you
California
get there
Adventure.
At 5
unless you're with someone who knows their way around a cell phone.
Right, right, yeah.
All right, now let's move on to everyone's favorite category,
merchandise.
All right, now, Avengers Campus had a very small store called Web Suppliers. And a small merchandise cart, maybe a couple of merchandise carts.
No, there was one merchandise cart by the bathroom.
I just saw that one.
Yes.
Figured you'd know that one. And you can buy a spider bot and customize it, like with the droid building over at Galaxy's Edge. Mm-hmm. And if you want to up your game at Web Slingers, you can buy these Web Slingers and
like go on your wrist.
Yeah, like a two-part contraption.
Right.
One has like a light projection. One has a little rope that shoots out of it, and apparently it helps you in the web slinger
ride
attraction. Yeah,
right. Yeah, and the thing with that is you can also use it at home with like projections and the little things too.
Right.
Like, it has kind of a two-part function.
Right. But if you don't want to wait in the massive lines within Avengers Campus, well, work your way over to Stage 17 outside of the land. Because this store has everything, and it has 10 cashiers, so you're in, you're out.
Right. All right. Well, Galaxy's Edge, by contrast, has your whole marketplace with six different stalls. It has a first order shop. It has resistance carts. There's the droid builders, that whole big store. There's Dock on Dars, which sells, of course, your kyber crystals and your holocrons.
High-end
things. You have Savi's workshop with your specialty lightsaber you get to build and a whole show. And it has a lot of specialty merchandise you can't get anywhere else off-world, at least at first. Now you can get some stuff on Shop Disney and some stuff at Star Trader. Yeah, that too. And some stuff off-world at Star Trader and things like that. But yes.
All right, so I'm going to say Galaxy's Edge wins this one. I love that the merchandise is made in-universe. So you get things like this Jar Jar doll, mm-hmm. and it looks like it was made within the universe and not at a factory somewhere in China.
Right.
And there's a shop for everything and for everyone, really. There's a shop for the high-end stuff, the plush, the apparel.
Collectors,
the costumes, a general toy shop, souvenirs, and Avengers Campus just has that one tiny shop. And there's something to be said for not having merchandise shops scattered everywhere, but Galaxy's Edge did it just right, where they made these shops in-universe.
Right.
And these shops are so in-universe that you're going to read about them in novels.
That's right. Yeah. You can also adopt creatures. I mean, how cool is that? Right?
Yeah.
So I think that's really cool.
Avengers Campus just once again had the spider bots, which we are giving one away. How do you win a spider bot? Well, watch our Avengers Campus videos to learn how.
Yes, and comment and like all of them. But Small World Vacations has been generous enough to give us some spider bots. Should I show them?
Yeah, go get those.
Okay. All right, hold on to Moochie.
Yeah. So, Kelly and Courtney, I know you came home with a lot of stuff from Avengers Campus, but was there anything that really stuck out, like a legacy lightsaber over at Galaxy's Edge, or even their Savi's Workshop lightsabers, and these little creatures? There's so much at Galaxy's Edge where I didn't feel like Avengers Campus had anything new and exciting and noteworthy other than these spider bots, which Sarah's going to show everybody right now.
All right, so this is your spider bot. Bam, 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 bam. And it is mechanical. It can move. I think it can have fights with other spider bots, right? I honestly didn't see much demonstration of these. We were just too busy.
Then watch our video.
Okay. Yes. But you can customize your spider bot with a character. And so we got this guy, this Iron Man tactical upgrade. So this is a suit that you put over your spider bot, and it gives your spider bot abilities that Iron Man has, apparently.
Yeah, and when the other spider bot that you're in a fight with wins, you can press a button and armor pops off.
The armor pops off, yeah. So this is like its armor right there. So
it's like those old smash 'em, crash 'em derby cars you had when you were a kid.
But this box, I mean, the boxes are really cool. Look at this. It's like a neat box and everything. A lot like the droid building, I would say, how you can customize it. And so, yes, these are giveaway items. It comes in a set that we are giving away courtesy of Small World Vacations to one lucky winner. So through June, we're going to have this giveaway going on our YouTube channel, and make sure to watch those YouTube videos about Avengers Campus to find out how to enter. The more stuff you comment on and the more you share, the more entries you get. Oh, Jack knows more than me about this. The Iron Man attachment, the Iron Man tactical upgrade, has its own projection and sounds. Super cool.
You know what? They did not demonstrate that.
No.
When I was asking, hey, let's get some footage of this demonstration.
Yeah.
The woman was just learning how to operate it.
Oh.
As I was asking her.
Okay. Well, I will speak my verdict with a little critique. So my verdict has to be, of course, Galaxy's Edge, which many of you are saying here in the Sky Chat. And simply because of what you said, there's something for everyone. you have the ultra special Savvy's Workshop, in which you get to build your own lightsaber with a show where Yoda speaks to you. It's amazing. And so now Avengers stuff, like at Avengers Campus, you know, honestly, I feel like it's more geared toward kids, which is great. I mean, you know, kids need stuff to do. And I think this is a cool land that kids like probably 10 and up can really get into. And I think that is great. Also, people who like the tech stuff, like droid builders is kind of equal to these spider bots, mm-hmm. right? So that's cool. But I do have to say that Avengers Campus loses major points on the fashion. Because right now, all the Avengers, like, things they came out with the Avengers Campus, like, I would get an Avengers Campus jacket, right? Or something cool like that. But it's all very black or gray or black and gray weird striped. Like, it's weird. And where's these superhero bright colors? We're an Avengers Campus. We've got superheroes who are bright and colorful. And so I didn't gravitate toward any of it and didn't get any of it because I'm very picky with my clothing. So I was very surprised that they did not have a bunch of Marvel character themed mini headband sparkly ears ready to go for the ladies, along with sparkly, bright, jewel tone spirit jerseys to match, kind of like they've been doing just, you know, block colors throughout the a couple years, right? Like if they had a bunch of these jerseys up for like Black Widow and Captain Marvel and Scarlet Witch, like all, like, can you imagine like blue and red Captain Marvel ears with like this blue and red matching spirit jersey or similar like Black Widow? Like, I think they missed the boat on this. Now, right now they do have Loki ears and those are the new ears right now, but to not have a bunch of Mickey or Minnie ears ready to go, I think was a major mistake and they're missing the boat because female fans, we are rabid for these matching set of Minnie ear headbands and spirit jerseys. I am one of them. I love this stuff. I even resorted to making my own WandaVision Scarlet Witch ears because I knew they didn't have them.
I'm thinking now that the entertainment side that runs the studio and the theme park, they're not talking to each other or else someone would have say, hey, you know what? We got Loki coming up this week. Let's just litter the place with Loki merchandise. We just had Falcon and the Winter Soldier. Let's get some Falcon wings out there for the kids. Get this sleeve for the Winter Soldier. Everyone would be walking around with that thing on.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, get it. Well, get the hype while the hype is like, I would have bought anything WandaVision. Anything,
and yeah,
like,
they missed the boat on that one too. Mm-hmm. All of the, like the Vision shirt that I was wearing came from outside the land.
Exactly. Yes.
So, yeah. So who's not talking to who over there?
I don't know. Yeah. But I mean, and the Loki ears were super cool. I just expected them to have way more. Like, how about a matching Thor ears, right? You know, Thor, Loki, it would be cool. So definitely have to go with Galaxy's Edge on that one.
It's always fun to get merchandise on opening day, but we walked out empty handed.
Actually,
except for that spider bot.
I got $1.50 bag that has Avengers Campus on it and it has cute little like Spider-Man stuff on the other side.
And right now the head of the theme park entertainment, they're going, whew. So glad we opened this up. We're $1.50 closer to being in the black.
Oh, I know. That's funny.
All right. So let me ask you, which park does it for you with all of the things we had talked about, all the aspects we just talked about?
I would say Avengers Campus to hang out, but Galaxy's Edge to shop.
Okay.
How about you?
All right. There you go. I'm going to have to go with Galaxy's Edge. And I say that because I really wanted to like Avengers Campus more than I did.
Oh.
With Galaxy's Edge, you feel like you're stepping into the Star Wars universe. And I love that. I've always wanted to be in the Star Wars universe. With Galaxy's Edge, you're there. There are laser blasts on the walls that tell a story. And there's nothing in Avengers Campus that can do that. If there is that, then I don't know about it just yet. But from judging from right now, Galaxy's Edge just has a bigger story. And you're not going to rival having the Millennium Falcon at the hub the way you do at Galaxy's Edge. Galaxy's Edge, I know, is lacking the music, which is really fun to hear at Avengers Campus. The shows are really fun to see at Avengers Campus. But overall, with the merchandise, with the food, with the atmosphere, I'm just going to have to go with Galaxy's Edge. And I say that because I can see the growth. Mm-hmm. Every time we go there, it's growing. Okay. I know Avengers Campus opened only a few hours ago.
Right.
But from what I'd seen, I didn't feel as comfortable as I did with Galaxy's Edge.
Okay, interesting.
And, oh, you know what we left out? The fact that Spider-Man flipped right before our eyes from building to building.
That's cool.
It was cool. It was very, very cool. And everybody oohed and aahed like they were watching fireworks.
Yeah. All right. Well, we do have some Sky Chat comments here. Kelly says, I can't wait to go in and out freely at Avengers Campus and really want to see it at night. And they ended their night in Galaxy's Edge and relaxed, which is always nice. But Avengers Campus is very exciting. So I guess it depends on your mood as well.
I guess it's like Avatar Land.
Mm-hmm.
Where night and day are two different experiences.
Yeah. All right. Well, you know what?
Well, that's the same with Galaxy's Edge or Cars Land.
Right. It's really different.
Okay. All right.
So actually, I'm going to go back through our verdicts here and count, because I do think Galaxy's Edge won for me just in the verdicts.
Mm-hmm.
But let me just see. So overall, Galaxy's Edge won for me 5-3.
And there you have it.
There you have
There's my answer. That didn't take long enough.
So funny.
All right. But with all those critiques, Avengers Campus just opened up and
yes.
It's going to be improving. It's going to be growing. And I'm sure we'll start to see that sooner than later. All right. Courtney just says, I'm glad we have both.
Yes.
Shout outs. Skywalker shout outs. Which Skywalkers get props from here in Neverland? Who was tweeted out? Shout out. Who was photoballed? Shout out. Who was shared a post? Shout out.
All right, now this morning we just posted our Avengers Campus opening day video and we've gotten a lot of fun reactions. And as a side note, in each of our Avengers Campus videos, like we had mentioned earlier, you will find details on how to win the interactive spider bot with Iron Man tactical armor. All right, so Jamie W, she writes, she's commenting on our interaction with Black Widow. She says, I love when Black Widow points to the sky when asked where Galaxy's Edge is.
Yeah, that was cute. Where's Galaxy's Edge, Black Widow?
Took her a second. Yeah. Like, oh, okay.
Pointed straight up. I love that. Darth Stormageddon says, love the merchandise. It did look really cool, and you found some fun Easter eggs in web suppliers,
yeah,
like the store.
That dry erase board.
Yeah, it was neat.
Mm-hmm.
Aw.
All right, Kelly Turkel. Hey, Kelly. She writes, I want to go again.
Yes.
They're just there for 3 days.
Yes.
So, you know what? That says something. If she was there for 3 days and wants to go again, that says a lot.
Right. Now, we also have a video of the complete Doctor Strange and the Mysteries of the Mystic Arts show. We had a fantastic spot,
mm-hmm.
Richard, right in the middle. And we have some fun comments on that. The theme park dude says, honestly, some of it is so cheesy, but I actually really love that about this. I want to see it at night, as I feel it is the best time to watch it. Yes.
Yeah.
Jack Vasfrey says, I love how they change up parts of the show so it's not the same every time. And I can only imagine how the show is at night.
Yeah, Dave Scale had said that he watched a video of the Doctor Strange show and there was no Thor.
Oh, wow. All right, so Amanda BB8 says, thank you for such an awesome video to hold me over until I see it in person next year. Yay! Mm. And Mary in the Sky Chat is saying, I'm on the East Coast and have a trip planned next May. Hopefully all the kinks will be worked out by then. I hope so, Mary. Me too.
Right, Patrick Horton in the Sky Chat says, how much did Skywalking through Neverland spend at both Avengers Campus, and Batuu. Well, we just went to Batuu and bought all this stuff. And we didn't really walk home with much of anything from Avengers Campus except for Sarah's $1.50 bag.
$1.50 bag.
When she goes grocery shopping, they'll know where she just was.
Yep. So there you have it.
All right, well, that wraps up episode 332 of
Skywalking Through Neverland.
We want to thank all you Skywalkers for joining us today and watching the live stream, commenting on all of our social media posts, and watching our videos. More videos to come very, very soon, this time on the food and beverages.
Yes, we're going to do a whole video on Avengers Campus food.
And as a reminder, Friday Night Pop Culture Trivia will return on June the 18th at 6:30 p.m. And then as a reminder, it's just now once a month. So moving forward into July, we don't know a date because our schedules are always changing. So just watch the Facebook group and the Facebook page and the newsletter.
And also, the trivia system has changed, so only 20 groups/people can play at once. So 20 people can log in at once to play.
So if you want to play, log in sooner than later.
Yes.
And we are still doing our Zoom discussion roundtables for the Bad Batch every Friday, and that time will change between 6:30 or 7:45. I know. I'm sorry. Summertime is our busy time, so we don't want to say one thing. Have to keep on changing it.
Right.
So, and details to follow.
And sometimes it might be on Saturdays. Sometimes it might be on Sundays. Just because of our crazy schedules in the summer. Yes, and Loki also debuted. So, the same time that we talk about Bad Batch, we will also, like, start and stop and then do a Loki. So
it'll be a Bad Batch / Loki discussion.
Now, if this is all too much to remember, or you just need to keep updated with the schedule, sign up to receive our weekly newsletter. You can sign up by clicking on the link in our show notes or heading to skywalkingthroughneverland.com and look for the tab, Sign Up for Our Newsletter.
Now, we want to thank our sponsor, Small World Vacations, for their continued support. Thinking of a trip to a Disney park? Well, you can fill out a Get a Quote form at smallworldvacations.com today. Their vacation planning service is free of charge, so check it out and tell them Skywalking Through Neverland sent you.
And speaking of Small World Vacations, you know, they have generously donated this giveaway of the Avengers Campus Spider Bots. So make sure you check out our YouTube channel for how to join. Just look for the Avengers Campus videos.
All right, now, do you love Skywalking Through Neverland?
Yes, I do.
Do you love all the Marvel and Star Wars shows coming to Disney Plus? Well, consider becoming a member of the Skywalking Force, our Patreon. Here, we are posting all of our WandaVision and Falcon and the Winter Soldier and Bad Batch and Loki discussions. We'll be posting all of those, so if you don't get a chance to join us on Fridays or Saturdays, whenever we hold them, well, don't worry. We have them recorded, and they're just there for you.
The Skywalking Force. So, make sure to head to skywalkingforce.com and check out all the levels available. And also, big, big thank you to those of you who are already part of the Skywalking Force.
Now, we are part of the Skywalking Network.
Skynet.
Where you can find other great shows like Talking Apes.
Classic Marvel Star Wars comics.
The Max EFX Podcast.
Neverland Clubhouse.
Resilience Squadron.
Totally Tell Me Everything.
And the new Star Warsologies. And a new show just debuted today where they talk about the ecology of Dagobah.
That's right.
And look for the brand new Skywalking Network YouTube shows, Collectopolis. And that's coming very, very soon. It would have been out this week, but co-host Ernie Moreno thought it was more important to be with his wife as she was delivering their second child rather than getting the show out.
And we don't mean that. Congratulations, Ernie. All right, Skywalkers, you can find us on social media. We are at Skywalking Pod on Twitter, Instagram, and TikTok. You can also join our Facebook group. So search Facebook Skywalking Through Neverland group and request to join. Answer the questions that pop up, or we cannot let you in. And please email us, share@skywalkingthroughneverland.com.
Now, don't forget to stick around for bloopers and other fun bits that didn't make it into the show. And
always remember,
Neverland on Alderaan.
Some imagination, huh?
To our Skywalkers and Tweetwalkers, thanks for listening. Skywalking Through Neverland is created and produced by Richard and Sarah Woloski. Original music by Rob Dellinger. Creative consultant, Mark Augushowitz. Technical advisor, Peter Heitman. Facebook administrators, Donald Wicks, Joey Pittman, and Norma Heitman.
Skywalking Through Neverland is intended for entertainment and information purposes only. Any sounds, music, and clips played during this podcast are the property of their copyright holders. All original content is property of Skywalking Through Neverland, all rights reserved. Sorry, had to be said.
All right, I'm going to hit the record button.
Yeah. Okay. If only we had someone there on the inside that could help us out.
Yeah, I don't know.
There's spider webs everywhere, though. I'm not sure why.
Nice. Jack also brings up a point now that this is kind of a little off base, but it would have been nice if there was a memorial or tribute to Stan Lee, like the Walt statue. That would be cool. Now, we have not looked at all the posters and things around the campus. There is a lot of Easter eggs everywhere, and I bet you somewhere there's something. Now, I know what you mean. You mean like a big statue, which would be cool. Like that would be a nice tribute. Or like even in Cars Land, they have that statue at the end of the street that represents like the first car or something, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So that would be nice.
If they could have a Stan Lee bronze statue, and if anyone says, hey, that's not in-universe, well, you know what? Neither is Black Widow. Well, except for in this theme park universe. Maybe in this theme park universe, there is a Stan Lee, and he should be memorialized as a bronze statue. Sometimes, like with Galaxy's Edge, they just box themselves in with canon and continuity.
Right.